hospital waste management. I know there must be a lot of things which might be running through your mind right now, that dude, this is an entirely theoretical topic. How can you explain this on YouTube? Somebody behind might be shouting, dude, pagal ho gaya hai kya? Theoretical topic hai, kaise padhayega? But trust me on this, I really have done the research and I've removed all the unnecessary wordings, all the unnecessary sentences which are there in the available source with me. So let's get started on this. Hope you like it, hope you enjoy it, and if you do like it, do enjoy it, please don't hesitate to press the bell icon and subscribe button one after the other, and please thumbs up. Okay, so let's start. Hospital waste management. First of all, we need to know what is a hospital waste. Hospital waste is any type of waste which is produced in a hospital. Okay, it can be any type of healthcare facilities. Okay, not only the hospital, it can be nursing homes and etc. also. So first of all, we need to know is what is a biomedical waste. So a biomedical waste, in short, I have written it short form as BMW, which can be easy and a little bit out of the course to remember. Okay, so it's easy to remember. Yes. No more nonsense on from my side, sorry. So what is a biomedical waste? A biomedical waste is any waste which is generated during diagnosis, which is produced in medical research activities, which is generated in production of vaccine, or during any testing of biological activities. Okay, so any medical field related activities, the products which are used once and cannot be used again are termed as biomedical waste products. Okay, so biomedical waste is a waste which is generated firstly during diagnosis, which is generated in medical research activities, which is generated in production of a vaccine, or which is generated in the testing of biologicals. Okay, out of the entire biomedical waste products, 75 to 90% of the biomedical waste products are termed non-risky and are termed as general BMWs. Okay, are non-risky and are termed as general BMWs or general biomedical waste products. Okay, and the remaining 10 to 15% of the waste products are termed as hazardous. What is hazardous? Dangerous. Okay, so 10 to 15% of entire biomedical waste products is hazardous. Okay, so an important now the topic to remember or to understand is from where the waste products are generated. So as I told you earlier, waste products are generated, if it is a biomedical waste product, this has to be generated from any medically related institution, place, facility. Okay, so it can be a nursing home, it can be private hospitals, or it can be blood banks, it can be veterinary clinics, it can be medical institution, because it has anatomy lab, your college has physiology labs. Your college might be having, if it is an MBBS college, it is having microbiology and pathology labs too. So yes, medical institution colleges also are a source of biomedical waste products. And one more thing which I forgot to mention here is pathological laboratories also. Okay, so during any blood test or urine test or any stool examination, skin graft examination, when you go to a pathology lab, it is also a source of biomedical waste product. Okay, now waste generation, if we take a look, it differs from country to country. Okay, so if a developed country compared to a developing country, waste products, biomedical waste products generated will be in greater amount in the developed countries rather than the developing countries. Did I say something wrong? No. Developed countries will be having biomedical waste products in larger amount than the developing countries. Why is that so? Because in every other thing, developing countries are having more amount of waste products, yes? But in biomedical waste products, counting is done based on the number of products you have. So the number of products in a developed country is generally more when compared to developing countries. So obviously the waste products, the products being used and forming biomedical waste will be more when compared to a developing country. Okay, if you still don't understand this, let me give you an example. If 10 products are used in US and 6 when compared to India, in India only 6 products are used. Okay, so obviously 10 products used will form 10 biomedical waste products, and in India 6 biomedical waste products will be produced. Okay, Then there are certain factors which depend on the waste generation. So what are these factors which depend on waste generation is, first of all, established waste management. So established waste management, what does this mean? So waste management methods, what does this mean? That how much methods of waste management are developed, okay? How much development has taken place in your country or in your healthcare facility for waste management, okay? So amount of methods which have been developed in waste management. Then it also depends on type of healthcare system you are having, okay? You are included in. Then it also depends on amount of reusable items which are used, okay? So if more number of reusable or recyclable products are used, then obviously biomedical waste products will be less in number than vice versa, okay? One more point I forgot to mention here is that amount of number of patients also, it depends on biomedical waste products. If more number of patients are involved in healthcare facilities, they are admitted in the healthcare facilities, then obviously the waste products generated will be more in number than the vice versa, okay? Then here is a numerical data, statistical data on distribution of this waste product. So there are certain categories in which the waste products are being divided or classified. First category is general healthcare waste. So we saw in the just few minutes before that 75% to 90% of the biomedical waste is termed as general non-risky waste. Okay, so that point is entirely printed here, copy paste. Okay, general healthcare waste is 80%. Then next, if we go from top to bottom, comes 15%. For 15%, this is PI waste. What is PI waste? It is pathological and infectious waste. Okay, so as I told you, pathological laboratories also produce biomedical waste, so it produces about 15% of the total biomedical waste of the 15% of the entire biomedical waste. Okay, and then comes 3%. So first number was 80, second was 15, third is 3. Okay, third, 3, easy to remember. Yes, it is CH and farm waste. What is CH and farm mean? It is chemical and pharmaceutical waste products. Okay, so chemical means any type of chemicals, okay, which cannot be used again, are termed as chemical waste products. And pharmaceutical products can be any medicine which cannot be used again, any boxes of the medicine, any bottles of the saline liquid which cannot be used again, are termed as pharmaceutical waste products. Okay, so 3% is chemical and pharmaceutical waste. Then you can see here two small geniuses here, okay? First one is 1% and the green one is 1%, and the red one is less than 1%. So what is this 1%? It is a sharp waste category. So what all things which are included in sharp waste category? It is the scalpels, it is the scissors, okay? All those of sharp instruments which are used in medical facilities are characterized as 1% of biomedical waste products, okay? And the last one is less than 1%. Less than or equal to 1%, but generally it is somewhat less than 1% only. So let me cut this equal to sign. Okay, so this is less than 1%. It is known as special waste. Now, what all things are included in this special waste are all noted down here. What are the things? Radioactive waste, cytotoxic waste, broken thermometers, and used batteries. All these kind of waste products are termed as special biomedical waste products, and it is characterized as less than 1%. Okay. So we had average distribution of 80% for general healthcare waste, 15% for P&I, that is pathological and infectious waste, 3% for CH and farm, that is chemical and pharmaceutical waste, 1% for sharp waste, and less than 1% for special waste, which includes radioactive waste products, cytotoxic waste products, broken thermometers, and used batteries. Okay, now the major health hazards which can be caused by these products are simple. Any biomedical instrument or any biomedical waste product is very much likely to get infectious very, very easily. Okay, so it can cause any type of infection. Okay, if there is a cut in your skin and if that waste product comes in contact with that area of your skin, then there are chances that you may get any any sort of disorder, not only viral, but any sort of disorder. In my mind, viral is going on because of the COVID-19 right now, COVID-19 pandemic, okay? But then chemical and pharmaceutical, again, the waste chemical products can easily spill here and there and cause distress cause rashes, anything. Okay, pharmaceutical waste products mean the medicines which are expired, which have expired. If they are taken, then yes, there will be hazardous side effects of that medicine. Then sharp instruments, again I told you, if that sharp instrument makes a cut on your body, then there are chances that it can lead to again any disorder, disease, which can be as fatal as AIDS. Okay, then genotoxic waste. What is genotoxic waste? Genotoxic waste is the waste which contains carcinogenic and mutagenic waste. Mutagenic means mutation, related to mutation. So right now COVID-19 coronavirus is a gene which has mutated itself for animal to human transmission, and then from human to human transmission again it has mutated. So those type of waste products are known as genotoxic or cytotoxic waste, containing carcinogenic substances, cancerous cells, a cancerous organ, then mutagenic waste. Okay, so any waste which is related to research in mutation. Okay, then radioactive waste products. Okay, then the last point of this video, last topic of this video is the groups at risk. Okay, what are the groups at risk? Yes, right now also you might be knowing what groups are at risk. Who are the heroes in the current pandemic? Medical healthcare professionals, patients once they've recovered, but for biomedical waste products they are also a group at risk. Okay, then visitors of the patients, workers in the waste laundry. What is waste laundry? Laundry, yes, it cleans the clothes. So all the bed sheets, all the clothing material which needs to be washed, which can be reused again, the people working over in the laundries for the hospitals also are at a very high risk of getting infected. Then workers handling and workers who are handling the waste products and also are involved in the transportation of those waste products, they are also at a risk of infections due to biomedical waste products. Last point is workers in the waste disposal lands or incinerators. Waste disposal lands, or which are created by the municipal corporations, or entire land where all the garbage and the dump, it is dumped there. But for biomedical waste products, there is a separate area. Okay, and incinerators are the machines which are used for disposal and treatment of these sort of biological waste products. Okay, so the workers who are involved in those disposal of waste products and treatment of waste products are also prone to have an infection due to biomedical waste products. In short, all the individuals who are indirectly or indirectly are having contact with the biomedical waste products are prone to have infections if they do not take the precautions, like wearing gloves, wearing a face mask, wearing a protective glass, protective goggles, a cap over the head. Okay, so all these types of things are the precautions for preventing any infectious disorder, infection caused due to biomedical waste products. Hope you like it. Yes, it was a long video, even longer because it was theoretical, but hope you like it. And if you like it, please subscribe, press the subscribe button, and also push the bell icon beside that subscribe button and hit the thumbs up.